Hi, this is Arthur from PromoTeam. Today we are going to talk about the key feature of Polkadot, which makes this project different from other ones. We will talk about the advantages that you can get from these and the slot auction process to be held in the future. This auction will reveal the hidden diamonds of the Polkadot ecosystem. But to get this advantage, you need to understand it first, right? So very soon we will have the auction for parachains in the Polkadot ecosystem, and it gives the holders of DOT and KSM an opportunity to enter one of the best projects of the Polkadot ecosystem.
Parachains are great and everything, you know, lots of people probably have this idea of, you know, making a blockchain and like having it plug into Polkadot. But we have this means of handing out parachain slots. You have to have a slot if you want to deploy your parachain. And we have this auction mechanism by which people can sort of come along and offer up dots for deposit or Kusamas, if you're on Kusama, in order to gain a lease for a period of time for a parachain slot.
So let's first try to understand what is Polkadot and its parachains. This is Polkadot and its ecosystem. Let's see the elements of it. Let's see our multi-chain future. Polkadot is the network that connects blockchains, parachains, or parallel chains. It is blockchains that connect to Polkadot and become an ecosystem. Relay chain, it is Polkadot itself or Kusama. This is the main chain that guarantees security and transmits the messages between the parachains. Parachains are part of Polkadot's infrastructure next to the relay chain and bridges to other blockchains. In other words, parachains are self-sovereign native blockchains that rely on Polkadot's relay chain for security and communication with other relay chains. Parachain slots are limited and will be auctioned off in a permissionless way. Rather than auction many parachain slots together, it's more likely that they will be auctioned off one by one so that there's only a single parachain auction occurring at any given time. Every network connected to Polkadot as a parachain will have some specialization, customization to deliver the best things like scalability, smart contracts, bridges, services, and things that we even can't imagine now.
A blockchain that tries to do everything doesn't quite do anything the best. And as a result of trying to do everything, it's just not as performant. If you can specialize a blockchain, configure it to be doing its one task the best it can, you can actually gain performance and as a result gain scalability. And then if you have all these specialized blockchains, ultimately interoperability is what adds the real world value. You know, these individual blockchains, these individual pieces of logic doesn't really add value to the overall network. But when you can have them talk to each other, communicate, and actually use each other, that's where the real world value comes from.
What's so special about a parachain? What features do they have? Well, a parachain is a native blockchain with customizable governance, block production, and tokenomics. They share the security from Polkadot's relay chain, ability to exchange messages and assets between other parachains, typically built with Substrate.
It means that every team that wants to get a piece of the relay chain can deploy their code on it. Yep. And the teams that turn out to be the ones that raise, you know, sufficient, I don't know, that have a token that's worth enough, or that have a utility proposition that's going to rake in enough transaction fees, they will be the ones that end up using more of the relay chain's capacity. And that's the way it should be. So it's a much more finer grained means of resource provision.
How does the Substrate project become a parachain? Now, actually, parachain slots are limited and are distributed by candle auctions or governance. Let's dig deeper into the process and talk about how it works.
Let's talk about relay chain volume. So optimistically, the Polkadot relay chain may support up to around 100 parachains. That's kind of what we're hoping for. And across these different slots, we're going to have different kinds of para objects, basically, things that are putting things on the relay chain.
It is estimated that 50 to 100 parachain slots will be up for bidding in the first auction. The full or maximum duration of a parachain slot is 2 years, broken into 4 lease periods of 6 months. Bidders may bid for selected lease periods. The exact date for the first auction is still unknown. This will be decided by governance. The number of slots available in the first round of auction is not known also, but it will probably be a number under 10. The winners will be determined by candle auction mechanism. In brief, in a candle auction, bidders can submit increasingly higher bids during the open phase. The close moment of the auction will be randomly generated and retroactively applied. The bidder with the highest amount at the closing wins. This mechanism prevents sniping, whereby bidders only put in a winning bid slightly higher than the highest bid right before the closing moment.
So the parachain auction mechanism. So the parachain auction mechanism uses a candle auction. A candle auction is this auction where basically, I think back in the day, they would light a candle and they would do some bidding. And basically whenever the candle went out, this is kind of a random time, the auction would close and whoever was the last bid would win. And for the same reason, and yeah, and I'll talk a little bit more about that, but that's kind of the idea here that we don't quite know when the end happens. This kind of auction is initiated by governance, so maybe a democracy proposal, maybe, I don't know if there probably won't be ever pseudo, but you know, you can basically say, hey, there's more room for more parachains, governance can go through and initiate a new auction. The auctions happen one at a time, and they auction off a two-year slot. These slots are split into four parts, which are six-month leases. What's cool is if you win this auction, you put your money into a deposit, but then you get all of the DOTs back to you at the end of the lease. Let's talk about the candle auction system. So the candle auction system kind of has two periods, this opening period and ending period. The opening period is basically time to allow people to realize there's an auction, to make the initial bids, to kind of figure out what the right general price might be for a parachain slot. But then you reach this ending period. And this ending period goes is known, it's fixed. And any time during this ending period, it could randomly close. But the way we do this is we actually let the entire ending period go through. So during this ending period, everyone's bidding, everyone's going up higher and higher or changing whatever kinds of bids they have. And then once the ending period is over, we then retroactively decide what the ending block is. So whatever the winner is of that block, that's the winner. And this is ultimately encourages healthy price discovery and just discourages sniping. I don't know if you all use eBay, right? There's some person, 1 second, who jumps the bid up a bunch. This avoids that. You don't know when it's going to end until after it's ended. So you're here trying to make bids which are truly what you think the value of this slot is. This also helps mitigate the effects of malicious block producers. So as a block producer, you ultimately have the ability to maybe ignore a transaction or not produce a block or do any of those kind of things. If a block producer doesn't know when it's going to end, they don't really have the incentive mechanisms there. They just want to collect their fees, right? So it kind of helps that. Another thing is that this kind of mechanism doesn't require a commit reveal scheme. So I think there's another auction called like a Vickery auction, where basically you can like have some kind of say I have some bids, it's encrypted or hidden, and at the very end everyone reveals their bid and all kind of stuff. That's kind of a two message process. Here is just the one message process. You can make an initial bid and you can win, not having to do anything else.
How much will it cost to become a parachain? This process means that the cost of leasing a parachain slot will purely be a function of market supply and demand. It's difficult to give an estimate as to what the bond requirement will be. However, we know that DOT will be the asset that needs to be bonded in the auction. It's important to realize that the actual cost of a parachain slot is not the same as the size of the parachain bond, since the bond is returned at the end of the lease period. The actual parachain cost is more accurately characterized as the opportunity cost from not staking those DOTs. Fact number one, preliminary modeling by the Web3 Foundation estimates the annual cost of securing major chains. For example, Cosmos, Tezos, and EOS is in the tens of millions of USD per year, with Ethereum and Bitcoin in the billions, while the estimated opportunity cost to lease a parachain is $100,000 to $200,000 for 12 months. Fact number two, popular dApps on Ethereum with 30 to 2000k monthly transactions like Chainlink, MakerDAO and IDEX and spend $18 to $16k per month on gas, which probably would be free for parachains. How to raise money for a parachain slot? In the beginning, we will face some battles for slots, and this is an opportunity for participants to get the tokens of the best ecosystem project, the Diamonds of Polkadot. Polkadot aims to give the power back to its users and has come up with a new model called Polkadot Parachain Auction. If a project decides that they would like to bid for an upcoming parachain slot but believes they do not have the required capital for this, then they can create a Polkadot Parachain Auction using the Substrate crowdfunding module to accept DOT loans from any DOT holder. Funds secured through this module would go into an account on the Polkadot relay chain. If the project is able to secure enough contributions to win the auction, then the DOT loans will be returned to the contributor at the end of the parachain lease period. If the project is unable to secure enough contributions and the auction is lost, then the DOT will be returned to contributors immediately. DOT in this account can only be used for parachain bonding, and the project are not able to transfer DOT out of this account. Since this module is on the Polkadot relay chain, contributors can trust that their contribution is safe and they will eventually receive it back, either at the conclusion of the lease or if the auction is lost. Due to the above characteristics, it's expected that project will reward contributors in some way should they win the parachain slot in the auction, such as rewarding them with native parachain tokens. In the traditional ICO fundraising, investors can only be rewarded with tokens. In a parachain, the parachain team also has the option to reward investors with roles in governance or block production too. What if the project doesn't win a future parachain auction? Convert their substrate-based chain to a parathread. Though this will not give them the same guarantees of throughput as a parachain, they can still utilize Polkadot's shared security and interoperability, but in pay-as-you-go model.
Parathreads get you everything that you would get as a parachain on the relay chain. The only thing that's different is the scheduling. When parachains retire, so assuming that they lose their slot, they don't die. Before, they kind of like the sort of retirement story was pretty messy. It was like, well, you can turn them into maybe an isolated chain, but it's sort of like going to be difficult to coordinate that. Well, now there's a halfway house. Now when they retire, they just retire into parathreads. Yeah. And then they can still continue processing transactions, doing exactly what they did when they were a parachain. It's just that they actually have to pay their way now, right? So in essence, the retirement story is much more graceful. And it need not be a retirement. It could be just a stay of leave. And actually, they're going to come back once they've raised enough to actually afford the deposit for a parachain slot.
Deploy the parachain to Kusama. This will require some planning, since there will need to be a parachain slot available on Kusama as well. However, parachain bond requirements are likely to be lower on Kusama than they are on Polkadot. Deploy their application or service on an existing parachain via smart contracts in Solidity or Ink. This has a higher development cost, but is an option for projects who want to utilize parachains that support these methods. Run their substrate-based chain as a solo chain and connect to Polkadot via a bridge. This requires gathering security resources as validators on the bridge and chain itself. So what is in conclusion? Everyone has a great opportunity to join the best crypto community with participation in parachain auctions. You can get tokens of substrate-based projects by locking your DOT or KSM, and after the lease period, you will have your DOT or KSM back as well as project's tokens. This Polkadot feature will make the Polkadot ecosystem the blockchain leader. Subscribe to our channel to get fresh info, announcements, and news about Polkadot, Kusama, and other cool projects.